last week, we'll look at it again. Since I firmly believe that the moment our hearts are empty of pride, selfish ambition, self-seeking, and everything that is contrary to God's law, God's will, the Holy Ghost will come and fill every corner of our hearts. But if we're full of pride, conceit, ambition, self-seeking, pleasure in the world, there's no room for the Spirit of God. And I believe many a man, many a woman who's praying to God to fill him or her when he or she is full already with something else. We understand this. We want God to move. We've squeezed him into corners of our life. He can move where we've allowed him to move. That's what this basically is saying. He can only move when we've given him room to move. Reminds me of, I think it's Isaiah 66. The Lord says, heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool. It's interesting. Now, what is it? What do we think about that? Hope God didn't have stinky feet or something? So a little smell down here? No, what's the analogy there? Heaven is my throne, earth is my footstool. What normally do you do? You kick off your shoes and you can be at home. God says, where is the house that you're going to build for me? That's what he says right after that. Where's the house? Where can I kick my shoes off and be me? If God could just kick his shoes off and be himself in your life, what would it look like? He says, this is the one that I esteem. The one who is humble and contrite of heart and who trembles at my word. There's this pliable, it's this kind of the same passage, similar to the passage in Ezekiel. I will give you a new heart and a new spirit. Some of us, our spirits have been broken. We need a new spirit. A new spirit. We need wholeness within our own self. And then he says, and I will give you Peter, James, John, Bartholomew. The different disciples, Andrew, didn't know that God had a dream for their life. A real dream. Until Jesus called them. Called them out of their own lives and out of their own vision for their life into a brand new life. God is a train, but it always involves leaving and following. Jesus taught them over a period of 40 days we've been talking about in Acts chapter 1. He taught them about the kingdom. He told them to stay until you've been doing the power from on high. The Holy Spirit comes. Because when he comes, you're going to receive power to be my witnesses. Right here in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, it's going to go to the ends of the earth, guys. If you fulfill God. know the truth, we must own the truth. To fulfill God's dream. What is this dream for your life? To know it is one thing. Many of us here know that breakfast is the most important meal of the day. We know this, but we don't own it. We know lots of stuff. We know we're supposed to drive the speed limit. That's the maximum. But we don't own it. We know we should treat our bodies well and eat rightly. But we don't own it. So the first step is to know it. The next is to own it. To say, so because to do this, it's a lifestyle change. It's not adding Jesus to the mix. This is what I used to say to the Weight Watcher group. I had my own hybrid Weight Watcher. Yeah, you need to eat the right things, but I didn't buy into it totally. Because to do that, I had to leave my plan and go to another plan, or else you can't do it. Then we'll say, Weight Watchers doesn't work. It only works if you work it. Right? It only works if you work it. You must know and own the dream. You must embrace discipline. There's a thought. At the heart of a disciple, let's just think about it. Disciples are disciplined. They follow a discipline. They follow the instructor. They're a disciple. A disciple of Jesus will follow the instructions of Jesus. We must embrace the discipline and incorporate a strategy. God has steps to get to the place where He's called us. That's a strategy. We must eliminate the obstacles. There will be obstacles along the way. We'll bump into this and bump into that. Because in order to follow Jesus, in order to say yes to Jesus and really follow Him, we have to say no to lots of stuff. It's the law of displacement. We can't say yes to everything. We have to say no and yes. Eliminate the obstacles. And we must see and seize the moments of implementation. We must see the moment that we're in. What does God want us to do now? We can't move until we see what this moment is. And we need to seize the moment. To see it and to seize it. Illumination and timing. And what season is it in our life? These are important aspects to following God's dream. To fulfill God's dream. How God wants to do it here and in the now, it's not going to look exactly like it was in Acts chapter 2. It was a different culture. It was a different people. It was different in many different ways. But there are principles that remain the same. And in order to follow Him, what will it exactly look like? I like this quote, the soul which has no fixed purpose in life. That people cast off restraint without a focus. They're lost. That's what it's going to take. When Jesus said, remember, it was during the Sermon on the Mount. And this is the way it is in the King James, which always bothered me. Because I said it's got to mean something more than that. I got into the Greek. Remember hearing this passage? Be ye perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. I might as well just give it up. How do you like that passage? It's right there in the Sermon on the Mount. I said it's got to mean something more than that. You know what it means? Be single focused like God is. Because just think about it. If you're single focused, then you can accomplish. That God is single focused. That's why he can do what he does. Be single focused. Simplify and be single focused. I said, now that makes sense to me. Or how do you like this? Quote, not George Carlin. I went to the bookstore and asked the saleswoman, where's the self-help section? She said, if I tell you, it would defeat the purpose. Many of us went, well, tell me exactly what to do. Not having Jesus in our life so that we can have a better life. And it's like going to the self-help section. That's why we come to church, so that I'll be happy to be better. That's not Christianity. It's a relationship with Jesus. And out of that relationship flows everything. That is what the Holy Spirit in our life is. It's a relationship with God. It's hearing his voice. It's being sensitive to following. God has great plans for us. Ephesians 2, 10. A couple different translations. Here's the New Living and the Amplified. For we are God's masterpiece. What did your neighbor say? You're a masterpiece.
You're a masterpiece.
He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Or as the Amplified, for we are God's own handiwork, his workmanship, recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that we may do those good works which God predestined, planned beforehand for us, taking paths which he prepared ahead of time, that we would walk in them, living the good life which he prearranged and made ready for us to live. There is a plan. God is not just a happenstance, whimsical God. He is major organized. At the same time, he's very spontaneously major organized. How? I can only relate to that is that when you know the music like the back of your hand, when you know a certain piece of music like the back of your hand, it's just in you. It's completely. Play the notes at the right time, but you are freer than anything.
You can play outside the changes.
No, you play within it, but you make melodies within the music. That's spontaneous. It's just, I get this, but you have to go really deep to go there. Because at first, how do you be spontaneous making a cake when this is the first time you're trying to do it? You can't, but if this is all you do
after a while you get more spontaneous. But certain things are absolutely true and you never change them. That's the way it has to be.
That is a dream.
Chapter 3 says, we serve a God that opens doors that no one can shut, and he shuts doors that no one can open. He says, behold, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know you have a little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Coach Taylor, the Lord is not through with you yet. You still have an open door here. And until the Lord moves you, you're to bloom right where you're planted. I just felt led to come and tell you that today.
Mr. Bridges, you believe God told you to come tell me that?
I do.
I admit to you I have been struggling. But I've also been praying. I just don't seem at work here.
Grant, I heard a story about two farmers who desperately needed rain. And both of them prayed for rain. But only one of them went out and prepared his fields to receive it. Which one do you think trusted God to send the rain?
The one who prepared his fields for it.
Which one are you? God will send the rain when he's ready. You need to prepare your field to receive it.
When we don't see, this guy, what? He didn't see. What didn't he see? So I don't see God working here. Isn't that what he said? I don't see God working. There are times where Christian life, we don't see it. Just because we don't see it doesn't mean that all of a sudden we're out of the will of God. That we just need to pack up ship. He said, I thought it was important. God will send the rain. The rain will come. Whose responsibility is it to make the rain come? Whose responsibility is it that God will pour his spirit out on you? Whose responsibility is that? That's God's. Then he says, are you preparing your field? The one who trusts him will prepare the field. To me, that's what Acts chapter 1 was. These early Christians before the Holy Spirit and prepared the field. They obeyed. They prayed. They waited. They got into the Word. The Word got into them. Different things happened. They were ready. They became one. They became unified. They prepared the field. Then God poured His Spirit on them. What areas of your life do you find it difficult to see and understand God's will? That's a huge deal. It's in those areas that we need to trust more. Isn't that right? Because if we can only trust what we see, we don't understand faith. Faith is the evidence of things not seen and the conviction of things hoped for. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. If you can see it and have faith, you don't have faith. Sometimes the real prayer is, God, I believe, but I don't believe. Help my unbelief. In what areas of your life do you find it difficult to see and understand God's will? That's a huge question. For you and God to work out. This means worked out. Pushed out. Or else, I'm just throwing stuff up here. You guys leave, and everything remains the same during the week. And this was just an exercise in futility. You're here, I'm here. Eat the meal before you. Don't say, I wish somebody else was in here. Eat the hay in your own stall. I'm a simple guy. In what areas is it easier for you to trust God? Think about it. Why is it easier for you to trust God in these other areas? Chances are, you see something. Chances are, in the clip, what was the man trying to communicate when he talked about the need to keep your fields prepared to receive rain? How does this apply to your life in Christ? This applies to the aspect of trusting Him. In the places that you don't see. This is big stuff. This is where a lot of people bog down. This is where a lot of churches bog down. As you can see in this area. Hebrews 10, great passage. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. How many of us have let our... How many know that confidence and faith are very similar? You don't have faith in it, chances are you don't have much confidence. Think about it. How you have confidence, you don't believe. I don't believe God's really going to send the rain. Why should I prepare the fields? You have little confidence, you're kind of going through the motions. It's like, oh my goodness, I don't know. I think I need to sell the farm. We have zero confidence. Do not throw away your confidence. What's the implication here? That some people have thrown it away. They've thrown their faith away. They've thrown their confidence away. Why? Because it will be richly rewarded. How many want a bonus in their check? From God. God will reward you. I don't know anywhere in Scripture where God has said, you just trust me too much. Quit that.
doing trusting me like that? Why are you trusting me? You're quit trusting me too much. I don't know anywhere that even remotely goes to that place. You need to what? You need to keep going. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't grow weary. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you might receive what He's promised. Is that what it says? You will receive. You persevere, you will receive. You don't persevere, what's the promise? Because at that point in my life, I threw away my confidence. I had thrown it away. And then it gave me the answer. I need to persevere. That's my problem. I've given up. Some things you keep in your tool bag. I keep that in my tool bag. This is one of my tool bags. I gotta have this. My righteous one will live by faith. There's no other way to really live for Jesus. There's a sense of freedom living by faith. I don't worry. If faith is at the front, worry doesn't have a room. You know? It just doesn't have a room. You know, God knows where we're at. God knows where we are. There's something powerful about getting into the Word of God because God speaks through His Word. Let Him do that to you. Maybe you set the Bible aside and you don't read much. Ask God, will you talk to me in this book? Paul said to Timothy, all Scripture is God-breathed. God's breath is on these words. It's like, wow, there's no other book in the world where God's breath is on. Some translations say all Scripture is inspired by God. You know, in order for something to live, it's got to have breath. God's breath is on this word. God desires to pour His Spirit on us. Are we preparing the soul of our hearts to receive His outpouring? Are we walking in faith? It's expectation. That's, to me, a huge word. You know that you're starting to walk by faith if you have expectation. You're expecting God to move. God has a dream for your life. Fulfill God's dream. Here's Peter and John. Remember that clip where Peter and John were in front of the temple? And the man was there and he couldn't walk. He said, "In the name of Jesus, come and walk." Well, this man went into the temple and he was leaping and jumping and praising God, and it raised a ruckus. They did it in the name of Jesus. And the people, the crowd was praising God. But the leaders were weirded out. They were totally out of control. They didn't know what to do. They really couldn't do anything bad to them because then the people would be after them. But they didn't want the name of Jesus to be lifted up. So they took Peter and John and had this little private meeting. They basically told him, stop doing this. But Peter and John, they had confidence. When they saw the courage, some translations say confidence. When they saw the courage and confidence